Blessed be our God.
Forever. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that would not have been told them they shall see, and that which they had not heard they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, cursed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole. And by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, and we have turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him, the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish, he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out himself to death. and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
My God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me and are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer, by night as well, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. My God, why have you forsaken me? Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted, and you delivered them. They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame. But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. My God, why have you forsaken me? All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying, "He trusted in the Lord, let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he delights in him." Yet you are he who took me out of the womb and kept me safe upon my mother's breast. My God, why have you forsaken me? I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. My God, why hast you forsaken me?
A reading from Hebrews. This is the new covenant I will make for them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
And they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am he, so if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, he said, now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered,
I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the police standing by struck Jesus on the face, saying,
Is that how you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, He denied it and said, One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
Did I not see you in the garden?
Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, They answered, Pilate said to them, The Jews replied, This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, Jesus answered,
Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?
Pilate replied, Jesus answered,
My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here.
Pilate asked him,
So you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate asked him,
What is truth?
After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I would be someone who would break the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?
They shouted in reply,
Not this man, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews,
and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them,
Here is the man.
When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourself and crucify him. I find no case against him.
The Jews answered him,
We have a law, and according to that law, God will not.
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who has handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin."
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
"Away with him!
Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but the emperor."
Then he handed him over to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'this man said, I am King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered, "When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, 'Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it.' This was to fulfill what the scripture says, 'They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots.' And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
'Woman, here is your son.'
Then he said to the disciple,
'Here is your mother.'
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture,
'I am thirsty.'
A jar of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said,
'It is finished.'
Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit." Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified, so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled: none of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. Please be seated. My custom for the sermon on Good Friday, as always, is to read a letter that was written by one of my colleagues, John Gibson. As you know, Holy Week is a time for the people of God to be still and reflect upon the great work of salvation that God has done through Jesus, from his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, hailed as a king, to his agony on the cross, condemned as a seditionist and a traitor. We walk with him for many reasons, but whatever they may be outwardly, somewhere within each of us is a deep place beyond words and rational thinking. The carpenter from Nazareth has touched us with his love and mercy. And so we follow, mostly in stumbling, uncertain steps. Good Friday is a time for meditation and contemplation, a time more to be with Christ than to think about him. I invite you today, for these next moments, to put aside the cares of the world, to be totally present to our Lord and here in this holy space. Come with me and experience the Lord's passion through the eyes and heart of a Roman soldier. Dear Silvanus, you're probably surprised to receive this letter from me, since it has been so long since we have seen each other, let alone written. But I am compelled to tell you of all that has happened to me in these last 3 years. I understand that after you became primus pilus and finally retired after 27 years, you are now prefect of the Praetorian Guard. I'm very pleased for you. Who would have ever thought that when we became soldiers together, whether we would become centurions, let alone men of such high rank? After becoming primus pilus myself and then retiring, I was asked to become prefect of the cohort in Jerusalem, but I turned it down. You may think this is a poor decision, but I must tell you, Savannah, since my experience at a certain crucifixion 3 years ago, I am a different person. My goal, as you know, was to become as powerful as I could within the army. No living in poverty for me. When I was assigned to this Hebrew outpost over 25 years ago, I thought that the gods had forsaken me and destined me to die in a hostile land, inhabited by a strange people who would rather die than renounce their faith in their one God. And a hard time it was, but I made it to the top. I'm here to tell you, though, that that means nothing to me now. You may think I'm insane, but first, hear what I have to say. The Hebrew people have always been looking for a Messiah, a Savior to deliver them from Roman rule. A quiet, yet not all unexpected desire, especially for people so fiercely independent and religious. Well, their Messiah has come, but not as they expected. He surprised everyone because, as he said, his kingdom was not of this earth. He came not with a sword, but with outstretched arms of peace and love. I might as well tell you now that I am also a follower of his. Yes, as bizarre as that might seem, I am one of his disciples, one among many now. Our number is growing steadily, and not only among the ranks of the Hebrew people, but also among the Gentiles, as we are called. I never thought I would see the day when a Jew would permit a Gentile into his home, but now we work and live together, telling all who will listen of this miracle that God has done. Yes, Silvanus, there is only one God of us all, the creator of the Messiah who is called Yeshua, or Jesus. He is God's son. He is God. I say that with confidence and faith, for you see, I have experienced and known his love and forgiveness. I, of all people, needed his forgiveness, because I am the one who killed him. Jesus came from Nazareth and traveled all over Palestine with a band of 12 of the most motley men you have ever seen. There was Peter, a loudmouth, impulsive fisherman who even today gets on my nerves because he's always putting his foot in his mouth. But I love him, and he is a man of profound faith. It was he who first recognized Jesus as Messiah and Son of God. He is the leader of our community. Then there were James and John and Andrew, fishermen too, and the most unlikely disciple to be chosen, Matthew, a former tax collector. You know they are hated by their own people because they work for the Romans. These and the rest were drawn by Jesus' penetrating love. He taught people to love their enemies and pray for those who persecuted them. You would certainly never hear that sort of talk anywhere else in the world. Let's face it, we got to our positions of power by eliminating our enemies. Jesus not only talked of the kingdom of God where love and peace reign supreme, he also performed miracles. He healed sick people. He forgave people of their sins. People who were, for all practical purposes, dead from the weight of the guilt of their sins were given new life by him. I'm speaking the truth to you. He didn't perform magic tricks like some of the so-called healers and sorcerers we have seen. These people were given new life. Jesus himself said we must be born again to see the kingdom of God. I know this is true not only because of my own experience. I have talked to others with highly questionable lifestyles, but have been forgiven and saved by Jesus. You know how cynical and mistrusting I can be. Well, I started checking out all these stories, and my friend, they are true. I even met a man who had been blind and was given his sight by Jesus. He is a disciple too. You may think that Jesus was a weak man who hid behind others, but I'm here to tell you that he was the most remarkable man of courage that I've ever met. And you know that I have met many heroes in battle on both sides. It seems that Jesus began to offend many of the Jewish religious leaders because he was teaching people that to love one's neighbor, no matter who that person is, was more important than keeping all of those hundreds of rules in their law. They were always angry with him and began plotting to capture him, especially when people began to call him the Messiah. They finally arrested him one night in a garden, Gethsemane they call it, and tried him before the Sanhedrin, their religious court. Then the strangest thing happened. They took him to Pilate. You have heard of Pilate, I'm certain. They wanted him crucified for treason against Rome. They could have stoned him, but I think they were afraid that his followers would cause trouble, so they got Rome to try him instead. Well, I've got to hand it to Pilate on one account. He didn't find Jesus guilty, but in his weakness and fear that the Jews would cause a riot, he condemned Jesus to death on the cross. That was where I came into the picture. Normally, I would have delegated this duty to subordinate centurion, but none were available. And Pilate was in such an agitated state that I took command of the detail myself. Right from the beginning, I knew that this man, Jesus, was different. He made no defense for the accusations put against him. He offered no resistance and displayed no malice toward Pilate, the members of the Sanhedrin, or the screaming crowd that stood in the praetorium demanding his death. Even during the scourging with the whip, as his flesh was cut to ribbons, he offered only meek and courageous silence. For some reason, I kept looking into his eyes, and each time our eyes met, I felt as though he had burst into the depths of my soul. I was terrified, Silvanus. I wanted to run away, but duty bound me to stay, just as it would have you. The soldiers made a crown of thorns and crushed it into his scalp and spit on him and hit him in the face. I wanted to stop it, but somehow I couldn't. The soldiers might have seen it as a sign of weakness, and as you know, that is something a centurion could never show. In fact, Silvanus, I wanted to cry for this man, and I have not had the urge to cry since I was a child. After what seemed like an eternity, we tied him to the cross piece of the cross, and add on that always endless walk to the crucifixion site. Here in Jerusalem, it is outside of the city, a place called Golgotha in their language. It means the place of the skull, an appropriate name to say the least. As you know, I have overseen many crucifixions in my time, but none like this. On that long walk, Jesus kept falling from the weakness caused by the whipping, but he never looked out in anger. Even when he was mocked by the crowds that lined the street. What a bloodthirsty lot. It was sickening even to me. And I guess that I have seen and perhaps done every sort of violence that man is capable of. Finally, we reached Golgotha. We even had to get a man to carry Jesus' cross for the half of the way. As they laid him out on that wood with the crowd jeering, I wish I'd never been born. I tried to keep my eyes off of him, but I just couldn't. There was a look in his eye of resignation, yet not despair, of pain, but not revenge. Savannah, I was looking right at him when the corporal drove those tense spikes through his wrists and his feet, and I could see the pain explode through his body with each hammer blow. My heart pounded so hard I thought it would burst from my chest. What did he do to deserve this? What could anyone do to deserve this most horrible of all deaths? Then they stood the cross up with a thud that shook his whole body. He hung on the cross and lived for only a short time compared to the two thieves who had also been crucified before him. One jeered at him, and the other actually asked Jesus for help, and he said the most remarkable thing. Today you shall be with me in paradise. He said something that broke my heart, Silvanus. I, the one who had crucified him, who had caused the spikes to burn into his flesh. I, the one who hung him there to suffocate the life from him. He looked out at all of us and said, Abba, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He finally cried out and died, and I don't mind telling you, Silvanus, I was glad it was over. I could tell you so much more of this experience, but I'll write again later. Can you imagine how haunted I was by this man, day and night in my thoughts and in my dreams? I could not believe this man could forgive me, this man who did not curse me from the cross and wished for me to take his place as others had before. I remarked at his death, truly this man was the Son of God. I would change that now, Silvanus, to say that truly this man was the Son of God. For you see, Silvanus, I am alive today. I have been given new life by Jesus Christ. You may think this is strange, but the story doesn't end at the cross. He was buried, but 3 days later, he was raised from the dead. Yes, raised with a new body, given by God. I was so haunted by him that in secret, I sought out his disciples to learn more about him. At first, they were angry at me and afraid that I would arrest them. But when they learned that I had to know about this carpenter from Nazareth, they took me in and taught me what he had taught them. I was there in the room when he sent his Holy Spirit to us and to all who believe. I am a new person, my friend. I have given up my wealth for the poor, and I now follow the risen Christ. You may not understand much of what I have said, but let me close by saying that for the first time in my life, I'm beginning to be free of the fears and the guilt that has plagued and haunted me for so long. I know what it means to be loved and to love. Yes, Jesus said, the kingdom of God is indeed here. May the peace of our Lord be with you, your friend, Quintanus.
Thank you.
Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that through Him the world might be saved, that all who believe in Him may be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with Him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you. Through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us pray for all the nations and people of the earth, and for those in authority among them. For Donald, the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for the members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help, they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and concord.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase, until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ. For those who have never heard the word of salvation, for those who've lost their faith, for those hardened by sin or indifference, for the contemptuous and the scornful, for those who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for those who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not yet know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray. that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of the Holy Life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter in the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world know and see that the things which were cast down are being raised up, and the things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us stand and pray together the words our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, we pray you set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, to your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.